Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. The topic of today's lecture is systemic lupus erythematosus. You all know that systemic lupus erythematosus is a very important disease that is important for rheumatologists as well as to the dermatologists. Not only the disease is important in examination, both in written as well as in practical, but it is also very important to know details about the disease, because whenever you will be setting up your clinics and seeing the patients, systemic lupus erythematosus is the one of the diseases in which a lot depends upon your clinical judgment and experience in treating such cases. So this lecture will be, I've tried to make it as concise as possible, but still there are so many things which you will be seeing in this lecture that is important, that are important. And everything is not important for examination point of view, but since this lecture is not only meant for examination, so I've kept those things in my lecture so that after the end of this lecture, you should be fully aware of different aspects of the disease, because Rook has covered this topic very well. The introduction and general description. SLE is a systemic disease that is characterized by multisystem organ inflammation, most commonly skin, joints, and vasculature, and associated immunological abnormalities. So you should also all remember that the main manifestation of the disease is on skin and joints, and vasculature is present everywhere. So wherever the vasculature is there, there is an issue related to systemic lupus erythematosus. The main clinical features include fever, rashes, and arthritis. So if a patient comes to you with a rash, the first question you would ask the patient is, that do you have any episodes of fever, and what about the joints? But in addition to that, since it's a systemic disease, you have to take care of the kidneys, pulmonary, cardiac, and neurological involvement, which occur in many patients with the disease. And these are the causes of increased mortality. Systemic lupus erythematosus is diagnosed by a detailed clinical criteria. This detailed clinical criteria is established by Systemic Lupus International Collaborating Clinics Classification Criteria, which is abbreviated as SLICC 2012. This criteria comprises of 11 clinical criteria and 6 immunological criteria. The clinical criteria include the acute cutaneous lupus and chronic cutaneous lupus. Acute cutaneous lupus include the lupus malar rash. Do not include if malar or discoid rash is present. Then we mean that it is only the macular rash on the malar areas. Then the bullous lupus, that means the blistering lesion, 10 like manifestation of SLE, a maculopapular diffuse rash, photosensitive lupus rash in absence of dermatomyositis, and subacute cutaneous lupus-like rash, that is the annular rash or polycyclic rash on the trunk. So whatever is the acute presentation of the disease, it is in the acute cutaneous lupus. And in chronic cutaneous lupus, it includes the classical discoid rash, which we see in DLE, the hypertrophic verrucous lupus, lupus paniculitis or profundus, mucosal lupus, lupus erythematosus tumidus, Chilblain lupus, and discoid lupus lichen planus overlap. So the chronic cutaneous lupus include all the chronic manifestations of SLE, and these acute as well as chronic conditions, they are included separately in this criteria. In addition to the acute and cutaneous findings, the third and important are the oral ulcers that include ulcers on palatal areas, on buccal mucosa, tongue, and nasal ulcers, and non-scarring alopecia, diffuse thinning or hair fragility with broken hairs in absence of other cause. So remember, it is a non-scarring, not a scarring alopecia. So these are the four findings we have discussed regarding the dermatology. Now the systemic findings. These include synovitis, involving two or more joints characterized by effusion or swelling or tenderness in two or more joints, at least 30 minutes of morning stiffness. So remember that at least two or more joints should be involved. One joint will not be sufficient as a clinical criteria. And in addition to the effusion, swelling, and tenderness, there should be morning stiffness. So this also comes in the criteria. Then serositis. Serositis means that their fluid is present in more than one serous cavity, like a pleurisy or pericarditis, and more than 1 day duration of pleural or pericardial effusion or pleural or pericardial rub. Then renal disorder, persistent protein urea more than 0.5 microgram per day, or the presence of cellular casts in the urine. Then the neurological disorders. Neurological disorders include seizures, psychosis, mononeuritis multiplex, myelitis, acute confusional state in the absence of other causes. So there are four cutaneous findings, there are four systemic findings, which include the synovitis, which include the serositis, which include the renal conditions, and which include the neurological abnormalities. And then there are three conditions related to blood. That is the hemolytic anemia and leukopenia less than 400 per millimeter cube at least once, or lymphopenia, that is less than 1,000 per millimeter cube, and thrombocytopenia that is less than 100,000 per millimeter cube at least once. So the 11 clinical criteria include the acute cutaneous lupus, the chronic cutaneous lupus, oral ulcers, and non-scarring alopecia, which concerns the dermatology. Then arthritis or synovitis, serositis, renal and neurological criteria that concerns rheumatologist. And then hemolytic anemia, thrombocytopenia, and leukopenia that concerns hematologists. Now, the immunological criteria. The immunological criteria include anti-nuclear antibody above the reference laboratory range, anti-double stranded DNA above the reference laboratory range, that is more than two-fold of the reference range, if tested by ELISA, anti-Smith or anti-SM antibodies, anti-phospholipid antibody, low complement levels, or a direct Coombe test in absence of hemolytic anemia. I repeat again, anti-nuclear antibody, anti-double stranded DNA, anti-SM, anti-phospholipid, low complement, and direct Coombe test. This is a summary of the immunological criteria. So for diagnosis of SLE, there is a requirement of four or more of these criteria in which at least one clinical and one immunological criteria should be present. That means a patient can have anti-nuclear antibody positivity, anti-DNA, anti-SM, plus acute cutaneous lupus. Or patient can have three clinical criteria like acute cutaneous lupus, non-scarring alopecia, or serositis, plus anti-nuclear antibody positivity. So if in order to diagnose cutaneous lupus, there's a requirement of four or more of the criteria, which include at least one clinical and one laboratory criteria. And another thing is that these criteria are cumulative and need not be present concurrently. That means that the four different criteria should not be present at one time, but can be present at different period of time in the same patient. For example, the patient has developed acute lupus and has later on developed antinuclear antibody positivity and later on developed nephritis. So these things, they are not present concurrently, but are present concomitantly. So this this fulfills the criteria. If the patient has a biopsy-proven nephritis compatible with SLE in the presence of anti-nuclear antibody or anti-double stranded DNA antibody, then it itself becomes a criteria for the diagnosis. Incidence and prevalence. The prevalence of SLE is at 30 per 100,000 in white people and 200 per 100,000 in Afro-Caribbean black people. So it is relatively common in black individuals. Incidence is estimated as 3.8 per 100,000 per year. Familial cases are uncommon, but kindreds have an increased incidence of other autoimmune diseases. So although SLE is not present in other member of the family, but other autoimmune diseases can be present. Peak age of onset in female is approximately 38 years and 44.2 years in men. Female ratio male is 7:1 and 15:1. So the different studies show a very high female predominance. Men with lupus tend to have higher frequency of renal disease, skin manifestations, cytopenias, serocitis, neurological involvement, thrombosis, and vasculitis. So men have more frequency of systemic complications. Pathology. Primary lesion of SLE in various organs are the fibrinoid necrosis of blood vessels, collagen sclerosis, necrosis, and basophilic body formation, and vascular endothelial thickening. So the primarily, since these diseases are called as the collagen vascular diseases, so the main focus or main brunt is taken by the vessels, leading to such as fibrinoid necrosis and vascular endothelial thickening, and then the collagen, which include the collagen sclerosis and necrosis. Histopathology of skin is similar in each of the different forms of LE specific skin diseases, that is acute cutaneous LE, subacute cutaneous LE, and chronic cutaneous LE. All of these autoimmune disorders is characterized by typical changes of interface dermatitis. Lupus band test was historically used as diagnostic aid in SLE. Immunoglobulins predominantly IgG, but less frequently IgM and IgA, together with complement C1q or C3, can be demonstrated at dermoepidermal junction by immunofluorescence technique. Such deposits are present in lesional skin, but are also present in clinically normal skin of SLE subject. If IgG lupus band test is no more included in the diagnostic criteria of SLE, this is because of the presence of other sophisticated serological tests. If IgG, IgM, and IgA, or only IgG or IgM are all present, the diagnosis of SLE is likely. So histology is characterized by marked basal cell, hydropic basal cell is not present here, and only patchy chronic inflammatory infiltrate. These are the colloid bodies or civet bodies which are formed due to the loss of or degeneration of basal layer. The systemic lupus erythematosus changes can be identical to discoid or subacute variant, but features are usually mild. And sometimes they are focal basal cell hydropic degeneration and telangiectasia. Here you can see the features are very similar to discoid lupus erythematosus, in which you can see the thinning and of the epidermis and basal cell vacular degeneration. Then there is hyperkeratosis as diffuse deep retinitis, then dense perivascular lymphocytic infiltrate. But like lichen planus, there is no band-like lymphohistocytic infiltrate. This is LE cell. I would tell you in detail what is an LE cell. LE cell is actually the neutrophil which has ingested the nuclear material from degenerated white cells. These are neutrophils, and the material you can see here inside the neutrophils, this kind of granular material is the degenerated white cells. And these are called as LE cells. LE cells were used as a diagnostic criteria, but it is not used, but this criteria is no more used in the diagnosis of SLE. Anti-nuclear antibody, I will be discussing it in detail later on. This is anti-double stranded DNA. This is lupus band test. This is done on DIF of the perilesional skin, which show the deposition of IgG and IgM, at least IgG and IgM, and sometimes IgA and complement as well. So the pathological features are mainly the pleurisy, pericarditis, lymphatic sac, endocarditis, lymphadenopathy, splenomegaly, and maybe none. And microscopic features include the immunoglobulins and complement at dermoepidermal junction of the skin, and as well as of involved skin as well as uninvolved skin. Then hemotoxylin bodies in endocardium and renal glomeruli, periarterial fibrosis of spleen, wire loop lesion in kidney. So we are not going into the details of pathological features of the different viscerals because we will be concerned mainly with the skin features and the clinical and systemic features of the disease. Genetics. The association between HLA gene and SLE have been studied over 30 years. The most consistent association is between HLA-DR2 and DR3 in white people. There is a close association between HLA alleles and autoantibody subsets in patients with SLE, with the strongest between anti-Rho La antibodies, NDR3 and DQ2. Autoantibodies in SLE. There is a long list of autoantibodies which are present in SLE, among which anti-nuclear antibody is the most important and is the most sensitive of the investigation. In addition, there is anti-double stranded DNA, which is very specific to SLE and is present in 70% of the cases. Anti-SM, anti-RNP, anti-Rho, anti-La, anti-histone, anti-histone, which is mainly present in drug-induced LE, anti-phospholipid syndrome, anti-erythrocyte, anti-platelet, anti-neural, anti-ribosomal. So there's a long list of antibodies which are present, in which the most important are anti-nuclear antibody, anti-double standard, anti-SM, anti-RNP, which is present mainly in mixed connective tissue disease, anti-Rho and anti-La and anti-histone, anti-phospholipid. If we classify these antibodies in accordance to the sensitivity and specificity, then you can see that anti-nuclear antibody is the most sensitive of all antibodies and it is present in more than 95% of the patients of SLE. However, the specificity is low, that is 60%, because anti-nuclear antibody may be positive in other conditions as well. In contrast, the anti-double stranded DNA has opposite features. It has a specificity of 95%. That means if a patient has anti-double stranded DNA, then it means that it is SLE with 95% confidence. And sensitivity is low. It might be not able to pick up few SLE patients. So sensitivity is 70%. So these two are almost reverse if we consider the sensitivity and specificity. Anti-SM antibodies have gained a very high degree of specificity for SLE, that is 99% specific, and sensitivity is very low. That is, it will be present in a few patients, but whenever it is present, it will be diagnostic of SLE, and anti-SM is included in the diagnostic criteria of SLE. Anti-histone antibodies have both 50% sensitivity and specificity, and mainly seen in drug-induced disease. Anti-La or anti-Rho. Sorry, anti-Rho and anti-La. Anti-Rho is SSA with 30 to 50% sensitivity, and anti-La is 15 to 30% sensitivity. In SLE, antigen-antibody complexes activate the innate immunity system through the stimulation of toll-like receptors 9 and 7 respectively. Innate immune activation culminates in interferon alpha and tumor necrotic factor alpha release by the dendritic cell. And this release promotes T cell to release interferon gamma, interleukin 6 and interleukin 10. The cytokines promote continued antibody formation. So this is the mechanism of continuous autoimmunity in patient of SLE. The antibody producing cells are subsequently inadequately downregulated by anti-idiotope antibodies and regulatory T cells. So stimulation is there, but the downregulation is not there. So these T cells continue in generating the cytokines and producing inflammation. So the main cytokines are interferon gamma, interleukin 6, and interleukin 10. There is a considerable evidence that non-organ specific antibodies, such as anti-DNA, anti-RNA antibodies, are not primarily pathogenic because they are not specific to any disease manifestations. They are not present in all cases, and their titers are sometimes independent of activity of the disease. So although anti-double stranded DNA is important in diagnosis, but it is not a primary pathogenic antibody. In contrast, anti-Rho are implicated in development of rash and heart block in neonatal LE. Antiphospholipid antibodies are linked to thrombosis and abortion in patient with SLE, and antiribosomal proteins have been detected in lupus psychosis. So these antibodies like anti-Rho, antiphospholipid, and antiribosomal P are important in pathogenesis of the particular subtypes of SLE. Environmental factors. Environmental factors are associated with onset of SLE, which include sunlight and ultraviolet radiation, smoking, infections, and medications like tumor necrotic factor inhibitors. Ultraviolet radiation, UV radiation may precipitate the onset or exacerbate the course of SLE in up to 60% of the patient. So very high degree of sensitivity. UV mediated oxidative DNA damage has been shown to induce resistance to three repair exonuclease 1 mediated degradation, resulting in increased local type 1 interferon production, and hence all the inflammatory markers. Infection stresses and hormonal factors. These include the bacterial infection, viral infection, and mental and physical stresses. Drugs. So the precipitation of SLE by drugs, especially the antihypertensive hydralazine, is well known. However, the drug-induced SLE differs from the spontaneous disease in some ways. Number one, it is uncommon in Black people. As I've told you before, the SLE is more common in Black as compared to white, but this is reverse in case of drug-induced SLE. It occurs in older age group as compared to the spontaneous SLE. Renal and central nervous system involvement are infrequent. Anti-histone antibodies are frequently present. Anti-DNA antibodies are absent, and serum complement are normal. So these 5 points are important in differentiating a drug-induced LE from the normal LE. Cutaneous involvement in drug-induced SLE may be vasculitic, bullous, or EM-like, and may resemble pyoderma gangrenosum. And there is less chances of having the acute or chronic features of SLE. Patients who develop anti-nuclear antibody during drug treatment need not have the drug stopped unless they have clinical features of lupus syndrome. Different drugs which induce SLE, in which the main drug is hydralazine, which is antihypertensive, which have high risk, and another high risk drug is an antiarrhythmic, which is procainamide. Then moderate risk is quinidine. Then low risk, the drugs include methyldopa, captopril, chlorpromazine, isoniazid, minocycline, carbamazepine, and d-penicillamine and sulfasalazine. So I'm not going to name the drugs which have very low risks. So I also expect that you should remember three or four high-risk drugs which can induce SLE. Clinical features and their percentage in SLE. Fever is a clinical feature which is present in 90% of the patient of SLE. Then arthritis and arthralgia is again present in 90% of the patient. And skin lesions are present in 80% of the patient. Renal involvement in 67% of the patient. Lymphadenopathy is present in 50%, pleurisy in 40%, Raynaud's phenomena in 35%, pericarditis in 25%, hepatomegaly in 25%, CNS 25%, abdominal symptoms 20%, and splenomegaly 15%. So you should all remember the first three features here, because these are usually the presenting features in a patient of SLE. Sometimes such patients will present with renal or lung involvement, and very rare they would present with CNS features. Clinical features. Due to clinical and serological diversity, the disease may affect almost any organ of the body and can manifest in broad variety of ways. The most commonly observed presenting symptoms are arthralgia, followed by cutaneous involvement. I've already mentioned this before. Presentation with serositis and renal abnormalities is less common. In fulminating cases, there is usually marked constitutional disturbance with fever, weight loss, anorexia, malaise, and joint pains, and skin may be involved later, if at all. On the other hand, the evolution can be gradual, starting with localized skin lesions and systemic involvement developing later on. Presentation. The diagnosis in many cases is made only by considering the condition in patient with an obscure illness. So when you don't unable to fit any disease which is bothering the patient, then it is usually SLE. As most patients are female, sex is again an important diagnostic point. So a female patient presenting with obscure symptoms, maybe some CNS symptoms or some abnormal chest pain, which may be due to pericarditis or pleural effusion, you should consider the diagnosis of SLE. Constitutional symptoms are common in patients of SLE, and fatigue is reported in up to 80% of the patients. Fever is common, weight loss is a feature, and again, 50% of the patient. Late onset SLE defined in literature as onset after 50 years, which is again not a common finding. The classification of LE-related skin is described by Gillam and is divided between those which are specific for LE, showing the characteristic histopathological appearance of interphase dermatitis, and those which are non-specific in origin and does not show the typical histopathological features, that is interphase dermatitis. So in the specific findings, the specific cutaneous feature of LE, the histology will always be of interphase dermatitis. And in non-specific findings, this feature will not be there. So what are the lupus-specific skin changes? The LE-specific changes can be divided into three groups that include the chronic cutaneous LE, subacute cutaneous LE, and acute cutaneous LE. Chronic cutaneous LE include localized and generalized discoid lupus erythematosus, hypertrophic LE, lupus profundus and lupus timidus. These four types of lupus are included in the diagnostic criteria of SLE. Subacute cutaneous LE include annular and psoriasiform lesions, acute localized and generalized LE, and 10-like variant. So 10 variant is present is one of the diagnostic criteria of acute lupus. And acute cutaneous lupus, which is associated with active SLE, characterized by cutaneous erythema, which is the most common feature on light exposed areas. In localized acute cutaneous LE, a butterfly blush or discrete maculopapular eruption is seen in butterfly areas, but there will not be discoid rash. It is only the maculopapular eruption, and it will be sparing typically the nasolabial folds. In generalized LE, a diffuse or papular erythema is seen that is present like a viral exanthem or a drug eruption on whole of the body. Photosensitivity is very common and is observed in 63% of the patients presenting with lupus-specific skin changes. So this is a malar rash. It is sparing the nasolabial fold. This is a generalized rash which we see here on the trunk as well as on the hands and feet. Sunlight and SLE are very closely related. So sunlight will again come again and again in the description of SLE. Sunlight may either precipitate or aggravate the existing disease. UV radiation from even the fluorescent light, from UVA from photocopiers, as well as the chronic exposure to indoor light source may also precipitate SLE. Because UV-induced lesions of cutaneous LE are characterized by a latency period of several weeks, many patients will be unaware of this association. So if you tell them to avoid sunlight, they would not be convinced, because it is not an acute exacerbation. It is always a chronic exacerbation. Systemic disease activity is increased in 3 to 6 months following a maximal sun exposure. So holiday in a sunny area for few days result in exacerbation of systemic findings maybe 3 to 6 months later. Occasionally more acute lesion with bully may form on exposure to sun, and the bully may be hemorrhagic. Importantly, rash in generalized LE and the generalized form of chronic cutaneous LE usually spares the distal interpharyngeal, proximal interpharyngeal, and metacarpopharyngeal joints, which are an important diagnostic feature from dermatomyositis. Because dermatomyositis would involve these joints and would spare rest of the hand, while reverse is seen in generalized LE. In other cases, lesions like EM, which is a Rowell syndrome, is also seen. Chilblain lupus erythematosus is again a form of chronic cutaneous LE, and up to 20% present with these perniotic lesions, which later on develop SLE. These lesions may ulcerate or may become hyperkeratotic. So these are the discoid lesions which we see in DLE. But here, this will be included in the clinical criteria of chronic cutaneous LE. And here you can see the targetoid lesions, which is a feature of Rowell syndrome. Lupus non-specific changes. So as I already explained before, that those cutaneous findings which are lupus specific, they will have the same histological feature, that is the presence of interface dermatitis. While the lupus non-specific changes will not be characterized by interface changes. So what are the lupus non-specific changes? Erythema can be seen over the hyperthenar or hypothenar eminences. Reticulate palmar erythema may also be associated with vasculopathy. Non-specific changes in SLE include the nail changes, the hair changes, vasculitis, urticarial lesion, mucinosis, bullous lesions, mucosal lesions, and other. Nail changes. Variety of nail changes have been reported in SLE. which include nail fold erythema, splinter hemorrhages, red lunula, and nail fold hyperkeratosis. Nail ridging, onycholysis, onychomediasis, and punctate or striate leukonychia caused by altered keratinization in the nail matrix. Mainly, the nail changes in autoimmune collagen vascular diseases include the changes in the nail fold and nail fold with splinter hemorrhages. The blue-black nail pigmentation occurs because of increased melanin deposition. This dyschromia may be diffuse or longitudinal and caused by medication, most frequently antimalarials, but also associated with cyclophosphamide, by methotrexate and gold. Although capillary loop dropouts or dilated nail capillaries are more commonly found in systemic sclerosis and dermatomyositis, this pattern is found in SLE as well. And if it is present, then it has a very strong correlation with Raynaud's phenomenon. And with anti-U1 ribonucleoprotein. You can see the red cuticle ulcers at the nail folds, then longitudinal striations are seen here. Hair changes. Hair changes include scarring as well as the non-scarring alopecia. It is one of the common manifestations. More than 60% of SLE patients will have a diffuse non-scarring alopecia, which is known as the telogen effluvium. Alternatively, the alopecia can be chronic and associated with disease activity, leading to coarse, dry, and fragile hairs along the peripheral hairline during the systemic flare. These kind of dry, lustreless hair are called as the lupus hairs. Permanent scarring alopecia similar to that found in DLE is rare. These are the lupus hair, unruly, dry, lustreless, non-shiny hairs. Cutaneous vascular reactions. These are very common in SLE, but these all are non-specific changes. They can be divided into two, the vasculitic and vasculopathic. And distinction between two conditions is important as their management is distinctly different. The vasculitis is caused mainly by primary inflammation of the vessel wall with secondary occlusion by fibrin, whereas the vasculopathy can be defined as the narrowing of the vessel wall, that is ischemic or non-inflammatory vessel lumen occlusion from thromboembolic disease. However, both conditions may present similarly and may coexist. So vasculitis is mainly the damage of vessel wall, while vasculopathy is mainly occlusion of the vessel lumen. Vasculitis usually present as small vessel leukocytoclastic vasculitis in 8 to 11% of the patients and cause may be drugs or infections. Involvement of medium or large vessel may manifest as retiform or stellate purpura with or without necrosis and ulceration. Other manifestations of vasculitis include gangrene, periungual infarct, splinter hemorrhages, arterial and bullous lesion, gangrene of finger and toes, which we see more commonly in systemic sclerosis. Vasculopathies. The vasculopathies present as Raynaud's phenomena in 20 to 60% of the patient and characterized by reversible vasospasm of finger and toes caused by cold exposure. Predictor of Raynaud's phenomena is presence of high anti-nuclear antibody and anti-ribonucleoprotein and antibodies. Livido reticularis is seen in 35% of SLE patients, and it may be seen in SLE both with and without antiphospholipid syndrome. So presence of livido reticularis, it is not necessary that antiphospholipid syndrome is also present. It presents as mottled or bluish red discoloration with blanches on pressure and most commonly seen on buttocks and legs. Livido racemosa is distinguished from livido reticularis based on the broken net type of pattern. Livedo reticularis will have a good network, while Livedo racemosa will be having a diffuse and broken kind of network. And it is a sign of more severe disease due to the presence of cholesterol or fibrin thrombi. Purpura fulminans develop in catastrophic antiphospholipid syndrome. Atrophy Blanchi type lesions also occur. And similarly, the Degos disease, like the malignant atrophic papulosis type lesion, also occur. Cryoglobulins have been observed in 25% of patients of SLE, with vast majority of type 2 and type 3 cryoglobulin. Since these are manifest as livedoid pattern whenever there is a cold exposure. Cholesterol emboli may result from release of cholesterol crystals during the spontaneous breakup of atherosclerotic plaques or intravascular or doing intravascular procedures in such patients. Purpuric infarction of tip and toes or finger and toes, calciphylaxis, erythromelalgia, urticarial lesions, these are all seen in patients of SLE. Mucinosis. Mucinosis is again a non-specific feature of SLE. Papular or nodular lesions both occur with microscopic features of LE have been reported sometimes. The differential diagnosis include the tumored LE. If solitary lesions are present, reticular erythematous mucinosis, then sclerotic edema or lichen myxedema, or thyroid-associated mucinosis. Other connective tissue changes which are also seen in SLE, which are rare, they're like dystrophic calcinosis. Dystrophic calcinosis is seen more typically in systemic sclerosis, but sometimes it is also seen in SLE. You see, in all autoimmune disorders, many features, they are overlapping. But in some autoimmune collagen vascular diseases, some feature is more prominent and other feature is less prominent, which is reverse in any other condition. So dystrophic calcinosis is seen more commonly with lupus panniculitis, and skin overlying calcinosis ulcerate with extrusion of chalky material, which is true with any type of dystrophic calcinosis. Subcutaneous nodules may also occur, which resembles the rheumatoid nodules. So here it overlaps with the cutaneous feature of rheumatoid arthritis. Pigmentary disturbance is not uncommon, and hyperpigmentation may result both in SLE and in DLE, like we see in SLE and in DLE. The blue-black pigmentation of skin may be because of anti-malarial therapy. Bullous SLE is a subtype of SLE, which is characterized by presence of bully and has three categories. The subepidermal bully in SCLE and acute cutaneous LE as a result of severe liquefactive degeneration of the basal layer and dermal edema 10-like. You see, the main histological feature of SLE is the interface dermatitis. Whenever the interface dermatitis becomes more, then it will manifest as severe 10-like reaction. Then SLE associated with other autoimmune bullous diseases, for example, pemphigus vulgaris, which is so-called as pemphigus erythematosus, pemphigus foliaceus, and paraneoplastic pemphigus. Then a third subset of bullous SLE is a separate subset, which is called as bullous SLE, is an autoimmune mediated cutaneous LE that results in subepidermal blisters. So there are features of other features of SLE along with presence of blisters, which occur both at photo and non-photo exposed areas. The diagnosis of bullous SLE requires the presence of SLE, number one. Number two, vesicobullous eruption arising, but not limited to sun-exposed skin. Number three, the histopathological features of subepidermal blister with neutrophil-rich exudate. And number four, immunoglobulin complement deposition at basement membrane on DIF. And these immunoglobulin deposition will be IgG, IgA, IgM, or C3. That is all the antibodies which are seen in lupus band test. So clinically, the bullous lesions arise predominantly on normal or erythematous, sun-exposed or flexural skin, but may be more widespread and heal with myelia formation. Anti-nuclear test is generally positive, and anti-double stranded DNA, anti-SM, anti-RO, anti-LA, and anti-cardiolipin may also be detected in bullous SLE. Dapsone, either alone or in combination with prednisolone, is the treatment of choice. Why Dapsone? Because this is a neutrophil-rich infiltrate. Response may be dramatic with cessation of new bullae formation in 1 to 2 days. Pemphigus erythematosus. A pemphigus erythematosus is combination of immunological feature of pemphigus and LE, and presents the lesions and present with lesions occurring in butterfly distribution on the cheek and in seborrheic distribution on trunk, like you see in pemphigus foliaceus. Anti-desmoglein antibody 1 and 3 are both demonstrated and both present in pemphigus erythematosus. Topical corticosteroids alone are usually sufficient, but systemic steroid, immunosuppressives, and dapsones may be required. Mucous membrane lesions. Oral and nasopharyngeal ulcers are one of the SLICC criteria for identifying patient with SLE. These lesions are usually non-specific, shallow, and tend to occur in crops. LE ulcers are usually not painful and commonly affect the hard palate. So you should remember these two features. Aphthous ulcer-like ulcers, which are not painful and present on hard palate. The non-LE ulcers, recurrent aphthous stomatitis, are usually painful. Mucous membrane lesions are of three types, that is erythematous lesion, discoid lesions, and ulcers. But ulcers comes in the clinical criteria. Chelitis is seen and malignant transformation is present in 6.9% of the cases. So on the nose, there can be ulceration of nasal septa and perforation of nasal septa. And lesions of genitalia, which include erythema of vulva and perianal area and vulval and vaginal ulceration. Differential diagnosis. The manifestation of SLE are so varied and protein that the disease is often referred as the great mimicker. The concurrent SLICC classification criteria may help in individual patients and have a sensitivity of 94% and a specificity of 92%, very high degree of specificity and sensitivity. The differential diagnosis of SLE include, of course, other connective tissue diseases like rheumatoid arthritis, like mixed connective tissue disease, Kikuchi, Fujimoto disease, acute viral syndromes, Behçet's disease, familial Mediterranean, amyotrophic dermatomyositis, and drug-induced lupus. Following clinical assessment, if pretest probability of SLE is high, anti-nuclear testing is ordered to support the diagnosis. The test is 95 to 100% sensitive for the diagnosis of SLE. The term undifferentiated connective tissue disease may be used in patients with symptoms suggestive of SLE, but not yet clearly ascribed to SLE. That is, some features are present, but complete criteria is not met. Anti-nuclear antibody and SLE, which is again a very important topic. Anti-nuclear antibody positivity is central to the diagnosis of SLE. Yet patients may be diagnosed without a positive anti-nuclear antibody test. The incidence of anti-nuclear antibody negative SLE is estimated between 1 to 5%. The concept of ANA negative SLE was described in patients with photosensitivity and anti-SSA or anti-RO antibodies. Concurrently, if an ELISA test or solid phase assay was used and the clinician's suspicion of SLE was strong, anti-nuclear antibody with immunofluorescence is recommended, which is more sensitive. The lupus band test or demonstration of immunoreactants at the dermoepidermal junction may be of benefit in confirming the diagnosis in SLE in selected cases, where anti-nuclear antibody test may be equivocal. So I would like to end my talk here because we have already consumed a lot of important details, and I will be giving the next talk very soon to complete this lecture. So what is left are the complication and systemic manifestations, the investigations, and the management of SLE. I will be uploading this lecture within 1 to 2 days. So I hope whatever I have discussed will be of help for you, because SLE is always a difficult subject and always confusing. If you have any questions, then you feel free to inbox me the questions. Thank you very much, and wait for the second part of the lecture soon. Goodbye. Thank you.